When Francis Patton became president of Princeton Seminary in 1902, it appears to me that he instituted a program for the professors to preach more than they had previously at Miller Chapel. And so for the next 5 years, Voss preached regularly there, more so than he would be previous or after. Now, that's the time when J. Gresham Machen was a student for 3 of those years. And so it is interesting that one of the turning points in Machen's relationship to Voss was hearing him preach after having him as a professor. In the classroom, Machen really struggled with Voss, particularly the biblical theology course. And one of the funnest things, again, discoveries you make when you're researching, I had become close to John P. Galbraith, a founding member of the OPC, and a pole bearer at Machen's funeral. And Mr. Galbraith gave me for the archives the present that he had received from Arthur Machen for serving at the funeral. And it was Machen's notebook, personal notebook from Voss's class. And in that notebook, on the very last page, in the most pencil dark doodling you could ever find, as Machen prepared for the final, he put, "I flunk Voss," right, in a big exclamation point. And so this was happened in like 1903. The next year, Voss preached at Miller Chapel on John chapter 20, Rabboni. I think it's his great sermon. I mean, this is like comparing children and you love them all. But Machen couldn't believe what he heard that day and how pastoral it was and how Voss had really gotten to really this relationship between the risen Christ and the very first person he appears to as the dawn of a new day is this weeping woman in the garden, and what this meant to Christ seeking out those who are lost and who know that he is their only hope. And it really, really changed Machen's relationship with Voss. He told his mother, this was one of the greatest sermons I've ever heard. And you could tell that from that point on, their relationship had changed. I think that's the way Voss's sermons now, how they interact with his other works, and that you can read these other works and there can almost be a sense in which you think, oh, this is this very high theology. But then you read the sermons and you realize, no, this is something that's covenantal. It's life flowing into life through what the Lord has done through the gift of his son. And so I think the question becomes, in regard to Voss's preaching then, is that even though he didn't preach regularly, he's doing something that I believe is consistent with the methodology of the Bible itself, and he's getting to the heart of religion. And the heart of religion is that God has made us in his image, and he has made us in his image so he could commune with us. And he established the covenant of works, but the covenant of works was broken, and that hope of communion was lost. But through the second Adam, that hope has been regained and given to us in a much greater sense than we could have imagined. And what preaching is keeping that in place and seeing then the centrality of Jesus Christ in all of life. And I think when that becomes the case, then his sermons actually are the most practical thing that you can read. And those who preach like him, it's the most practical message that you could deliver, because it's about the cultivation of communion with God, that for which we were made.